Hey everybody, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed, the television edition. We are live. It is February 11th, 2015. For those of you who are watching live, so welcome. Just flying solo today, but we'll get the housekeeping out of the way because next week, right here on the television edition, Jen Coffey and I will be talking with Congressman Frank Ginta from the great state of New Hampshire. So looking forward to that. He will be here with us in the studio. And it's actually the first time that we'll have a sitting U.S. congressman live with us here on this program. So, you know, we've interviewed candidates, but this will be our first time with an actual lawmaker who sits in Washington when he's when Congress is in session, if you like that term, lawmaker. So that'll be very cool. So Jen and I will be doing that this week. Today, it's going to be kind of a grab bag of stuff since I'm here by myself. I did pick a few things as I like to do, usually very last minute right before coming on the air. So I will remind you, of course, and this is the housekeeping part, that we do get the show up typically by about 10 p.m. every Wednesday. So if you're not able to watch it live, or if you happen to be watching it live this week but can't always catch it live, it does go up on IPMNation.com later on. Usually by about 10 p.m. Wednesday night, we have it up. So, and in addition to that, we're on a little bit of a new schedule as far as rock, paper, hand grenades. In the past, we've been a week behind on getting those shows up. You had to either watch it live or catch one of the replays before it was available on demand. Now we're only a day behind. So now, rock, paper, hand grenades, if you also enjoy that program, the show that I co-host with the Honorable Gary S. Hopper. That is, of course, live Wednesdays at 6 p.m. right here. But then it will be available the next day, probably late afternoon, early evening, also on IPMNation.com. We've always archived all the episodes of the show there. But now it's we're getting them up in a more timely fashion. So a lot of cool changes. And speaking of cool changes, today is the day that our new IPMNation.com 24/7 live radio stream will feature its first full-length program. We had John Heichel of Uptown Auto Repair on the show a few weeks ago, and Uptown Auto Repair in Manchester is our sponsor of the new IPMNation.com live stream, our new radio network that's always on, not just on-demand content. And that went up recently. It did become active, but we've been slowly adding to it. And right now, there's a lot of music streaming on it because it is going to be, in addition to, as we discussed before, a lot of talk show programming, a lot of politics, and there's a comedy program that's going to be running on it, a lot of different things, a lot of cool stuff. But there's also music there as well. And right now, like I said, it's been streaming a lot of music, but tonight at 7 p.m. Eastern Time on IPMNation.com, on the live stream, will be the premiere of Local Outbreak. That's a radio show that I've been doing for about 6 years now. It currently runs, if you're in central New Hampshire, it runs on 100.1 The Planet, Saturday nights at 9 p.m. and then replays every Wednesday at 7 p.m., new episode every Saturday, and then the replay Wednesday. And all the shows are archived at IPMNation.com/localoutbreak. But we're also going to start, beginning tonight, we're going to start streaming the show on IPMNation.com at the same time that it's also airing on 100.1 The Planet. So if you want to hear the show, but you're in an area where you can't get The Planet, you can just go to IPMNation.com at the same time and hear it there streaming also. So, so that will be the first full-length show to air on our new IPMNation.com 24/7 live stream. And we're going to be adding a lot more programming to it in the coming days. It will probably be a lot more talk shows than music, to be honest with you. A lot of political stuff. Tonight, Jen Coffey and I are going to record the first episode of The Pork Report, one of the shows that she's going to be doing for us on IPM Nation. And no, it's The Pork Report. It's not about, you know, ham and bacon and stuff like that. Pork, P-O-R-C, as in porcupine. If you don't know what that is, look it up. We won't get into all that right now. But if you do know, you're going to want to hear this show. So that's going to be recorded this evening, and then we'll announce when the actual air date will be forthcoming. So a lot of cool stuff happening at IPM Nation. A lot of cool stuff at DKRN.FM as well. There is an edition of the television edition, of course, the radio edition of Unleashed, which is every Tuesday and Thursday night at 9 p.m. Eastern on DKRN.FM. Or you can get it on your mobile device at dkrn.fm/mobile. Very, very easy. And we're going to be running that on ipmnation.com as well. You can stream it through ipmnation.com, but we're also going to be adding that to the live channel. And by the way, all the on-demand programming currently on ipmnation.com will continue to be there. That's not going away. We're not replacing it with the live stream. It's just another component to it so that we can do more and more live programming in addition to recorded content on IPM Nation. So anyway, so there's my housekeeping. I learned something interesting. And like I said, today is going to be kind of a grab bag of stuff. I don't have any one thing I'm going to focus on for the next 50 minutes or so, because I already ate up 6 minutes with my housekeeping. But I learned something interesting that was a big surprise to me. We've talked on the show about Rand Paul. I'm not a Rand Paul supporter, but I think he's interesting. I do like some of his foreign policy positions, etc. But he has a problem, of course. He obviously wants to run for president, hasn't announced anything. You know, he's in that exploratory phase. He's been here to New Hampshire where we are raising money and so forth. But he has a problem. And the problem is he's also up for re-election to his U.S. Senate seat in 2016 in Kentucky. And according to Kentucky law, you can't be on the ballot for both. No name can appear on the ballot twice. So he has to make a decision. He's one of those individuals who's going to have to decide if he wants to give up his Senate seat to make a run for the presidency, because he can't run for both simultaneously. I also was not aware, by the way, until recently, and this isn't the main thing, but I was not aware that of how common that is in our history, where someone continues to run, you know, kind of hedging your bets. If you think about it, it's smart. You know, there's no guarantee you're going to win the presidency or the vice presidency or whatever. So if you can also be on the ballot for, if you're a current U.S., a sitting U.S. senator or congressman or what have you, you know, if you can stay on the ballot for that as well, you know, kind of hedge your bets. If the dream job doesn't work out, you still got your other gig to fall back on. So Rand Paul, as we've discussed on the show, is in a tough position. And he's not getting any help. Allison Lundergan Grimes, the current secretary Attorney General, state Attorney General in Kentucky, who, of course, challenged Mitch McConnell in 2014 for his Senate seat. She's a Democrat. She's not going to help him. What they were counting on in Kentucky was that there would be a flip, that this Republican wave that we saw nationally would include the Kentucky state legislature. And from what I understand, they had every reason to believe that that was going to happen. It did not. So very difficult to get the law changed. It's difficult to get the law changed to favor a Republican when you have a democratically controlled state legislature. So he's kind of SOL. So he's going to have to make a decision. What I learned the other day was he's not the only one in this position. In a similar spot is Florida Senator Marco Rubio. Who apparently not only does he become thirsty at inconvenient times, Senator Rubio, he is in a similar predicament. According to Florida state law, you cannot be on the ballot twice. So he also, you know, he's expressed great interest in running for the presidency. He's also going to have to make a decision. He cannot run for re-election for his Senate seat and run for the presidency. In Florida, you know, maybe they can change the law for him. Like I said, in Kentucky, it doesn't look like that's going to happen for Senator Paul. So I thought that was interesting. So there's actually two prospective Republican candidates in the same boat. So maybe neither of them will run. Maybe it's going to be Jeb. Wouldn't surprise me to see Jeb Bush as a 2016 nominee. What would surprise me is Scott Walker. Scott Walker, of course, governor of Wisconsin. He's also in that exploratory phase. I don't think there's anyone who's made any kind of official announcement. Well, aside from Mitt Romney, of course, who announced that he would not be running. Scott Walker surprises me. I don't think he'll get very far. I could see him possibly being picked by whoever the nominee is to be the VP, but I can't really imagine him as the nominee. I don't think, from what I've seen of him, I don't think he'll be able to connect with voters going through the primaries the way some of these other folks can. Marco Rubio, Senator Marco Rubio, Florida. Excuse me a moment. Just mentioning his name makes me so thirsty. He I think, is a likable enough guy. I think he can connect. I think Rand Paul, I don't know if I'd call him warm and fuzzy, but he does have a certain charisma about him. I think he can connect. And Jeb seems likable enough, you know. But I don't think Scott Walker, to me, comes across as not particularly charismatic or likable. So I don't think he's got much of a shot. But, you know, there are other reasons to run for president. You don't run for president just because you want to be president. You know, you got a shot at being picked for VP, for example. Or you might be treating the whole thing like a glorified book tour. You know, Newt Gingrich, obviously, when he ran in 2012, you know, he knew he wasn't going to be the nominee, although there was a brief moment where it looked like he might be. But everybody kind of had a turn as the front runner. It was pretty wild. But, you know, he's always writing books. His wife, Calista, is always writing books. They're producing documentaries. You know, he's always got something to promote. And a lot of his campaign stops literally were book signings. He and his wife doing book signings. Herman Cain had a book out. You know, we all knew Herman Cain wasn't going to be the nominee, but he did have a book to promote. Rick Santorum, I believe, he's written, I don't think he's anywhere near as prolific as Gingrich, but I know he's written at least a couple books. I think he's always got a book to promote. So, you know, there are other reasons to run, so we'll see. Maybe Scott Walker, I don't know if he's written anything. Maybe he does have something coming out that he wants to promote. I don't think he's going to be the nominee. Let's talk about our current president. And this might be a good time. You know, I don't think I've done this lately. It's a new year. And I know, too, that we have a lot of renewed, a lot of new viewers who are coming to the show, watching it online, with everything that's been going on, with all the new stuff happening with IPMNation.com. And, you know, and Jen's been doing a lot of great promotion, and some of the guests that she's booked have helped a lot, bring a lot of new attention to the show. So for those who don't know, because I know I confuse some people, I'll just kind of reset this quickly. This won't take long. But I'm an independent. I'm neither a Republican or a Democrat. This is a good time to remind everybody, because I'm about to probably be more than a little bit critical of our president on a couple things. So some people who are new to the show will hear me criticizing Obama on something and assume that I must be a Republican. I am not. I was a Democrat up until mid-2000s, maybe 2006, and I left the party and became an independent. Sometimes some of my Republican friends will ask me, well, Matt, if you were so dissatisfied with the Democrats, why don't you come be a Republican? And my response to that is usually something along the lines of, I don't think so. I am an independent, and because I am such, I have a lot of criticism for both sides. So I'm one of the, well, I'm the only person who has had this very specific thing happen, but I have the unique distinction of, within a 24-hour period, it was something related to this show, an episode of the show, I actually had a Democrat call me a Republican apologist and a Republican publicly call me an Obama Kool-Aid drinker, all within a 24-hour span. So how I'm perceived, I guess, depends on what the issue is that I'm talking about. Some people have a very difficult time wrapping their minds around the idea that you can be an independent, that you can be, as I regard myself, a centrist. Some people, you know, say, you know, pick a side. You're either a liberal or a conservative. I once heard Laura Ingraham, whom I'm not a particularly big fan of, but, you know, conservative talk show host Laura Ingraham, refer to people like me as being part of the mushy middle. Because people like me, we can't decide which ideology to go with. So we're in the mushy middle. She speaks very derisively of centrists, you know. So you either have to be a right-wing, patriotic, America-loving conservative, or you're a Marxist, commie, liberal, flower child, peacenik, whatever. And a lot of people kind of think that way to varying degrees. But I am an independent. There are things about both parties, both ideologies, actually all three, liberalism, conservatism, and of course libertarianism. All three of those ideologies have things about them that I relate to, that I agree with, and all three of them have certain things about them that I find frankly, repulsive. More so, not so much in terms of the ideologies, but the parties that represent those ideologies. Well, at least the Democrats and the Republicans I find repulsive. Libertarians, you know, honestly, of the three, I probably identify most with libertarians because they tend to be kind of liberal on some social issues and kind of conservative economically, but a little too conservative economically for my taste. So, gun to my head, if I had to pick an ideology at this point, I would probably go with libertarianism. I probably agree with them on the most stuff. But even libertarians, I have concerns. So for anyone new to the show, there you have it. You will hear me pick on everybody about something. And I wanted to get that out there. So anyone new who hears me pick on Obama, as I'm about to do, no, I'm not a Republican. I actually voted for Obama in 2008, as a matter of fact. I did not vote for him in 2012. I voted for Libertarian candidate Gary Johnson. But there you go. I voted for very few Republicans in my life. But I have voted for Republicans. If you add it all up, I've probably voted for way more Democrats than anybody else. But again, keep in mind, up until mid-2000s, I was still a Democrat. But this thing I want to criticize Obama on kind of plays into part of why I felt compelled to leave the Democratic Party. So this is from Reuters. And I have no idea how to pronounce the name of the person who authored this article, but it's from Reuters. I usually like to give the credit, but Obama slams Staples, big companies on healthcare. Shame on them, he says. This went up this morning, a little bit before 9 a.m. Very short article. I'll read this to you and then I'll comment. And I'll probably sub-reference and go off on tangents, as I often do. Again, if you're new to the show, I do that. February 11th, U.S. President Barack Obama singled out office supply giant Staples, Inc. as undercutting his healthcare reform law and said large corporations should not use the health insurance issue as an excuse for cutting wages, the news website BuzzFeed reported. Quote, it's one thing when you've got a mom and pop store who can't afford to provide paid sick leave or health insurance or minimum wage to workers. But when I hear large corporations that make billions of dollars in profits trying to blame our interest in providing health insurance as an excuse for cutting back workers' wages, shame on them, unquote, Obama said in an interview with BuzzFeed. The Affordable Care Act requires companies with more than 50 employees to pay for health insurance for people who work 30 hours or more a week. Reuters has reported that some businesses are keeping staffing numbers below 50 or cutting the work week to less than 30 hours to avoid providing employee health insurance. Staples, the number one in U.S. office supply retailer, has told its employees not to work more than 25 hours per week, according to a BuzzFeed report on Monday. Staples CEO Ronald Sargent brought home $10.8 million in total compensation in 2013. The company reported net profit of $620.1 million in net profit through February 1st, 2014. Obama said in the interview, quote, there is no reason for an employer who is not currently providing health care to their workers to discourage them from either getting health insurance on the job or being able to avail themselves of the Affordable Care Act. I haven't looked at Staples stock lately or what the compensation of the CEO is, but I suspect that they could well afford to treat their workers favorably and give them some basic financial security. And if they can't, then they should be willing to allow those workers to get the Affordable Care Act without cutting wages, unquote. Staples representatives were not immediately available for comment on Tuesday. They're not going to respond to something the president says, sort of condemning them. There's really no reason to from a PR standpoint. They're better off ignoring it. It is unusual for the president to single out a specific company or corporation. But nearly 7.5 million people have signed up for 2015 Obamacare health plans through healthcare.gov, with demand increasing as a February 15th enrollment deadline approaches, according to government figures. Staples and number two office retailer Office Depot, Inc. announced last week that $6.3 billion plan to join forces to compete against big box stores and online rivals. All right. Here is where this plays into why I left the Democratic Party. You know, I'm an entrepreneur. I started, IPM Nation. Well, the original company, Impact Player Music, back in 2000, actually, was the year. Wow, it's been 15 years. So, you know, I having been an entrepreneur for a while, it's difficult, I find, ideologically, to be an entrepreneur and to be a Democrat, because I have a pretty intense seething hatred for government bureaucracy. Now, I'm not, again, I'm not a libertarian. I'm not someone who says there should be no government regulations on anything and businesses should be completely unregulated. I do believe in things like, for example, labor laws, some environmental protections I think are necessary. Yes, I do believe in climate change and that we're affecting it. You know, I do believe that capitalism, while it is a good thing, I am a capitalist. I believe in capitalism. But like many good things, there is a dark side to it. So I do think there has to be some government regulation in terms of how people are treated. The problem is liberals tend to, in my view, and I think this is one of the things that, you know, some of my Republican friends try to tag me as a liberal. But I'm not too liberal on this stuff. You know, I mean, I'm, you know, yeah, I'm pro-choice, I'm pro-gay marriage. I'm, you know, there's a bunch of liberal positions I hold. But I think that government tends to overreach. And I think Obamacare is a big overreach. You know, my views on the Affordable Care Act from the beginning were, yes, I absolutely believe that some sort of healthcare reform was necessary in this country. I think, you know, the idea that in the most prosperous, most innovative country in the history of the world, that we can't figure out a way to make sure that everyone has access to, regardless of income level, regardless of circumstance, medical history, et cetera, to make sure that everyone has access to adequate or preferably better than adequate healthcare, you're never going to convince me that that's impossible in this country. Of course it's possible. If there's anyone who can figure out a way to do it, we should be able to. I just thought that Obamacare was the wrong way to do it. I would have preferred to see a more free market-based version of healthcare reform, where you actually remove some of the onerous government regulations so that you actually lessen government's involvement in the healthcare system, not increase it. You don't make something more accessible and affordable for people by adding additional layers of bureaucracy to it. If anything, you got to pull back on some of that. And so that's what I don't like about the Affordable Care Act. And that's why, frankly, I blame both parties for where we are now with all of this, because, you know, I blame the Democrats for their love of bureaucracy, frankly, and big government. So, you know, they don't see the problem. Liberals reflexively don't see any issue with increasing bureaucracy and increasing government regulation. And if government ends up with some sort of input on every aspect of your life, that's just fine. I mean, I'm, you know, not that all liberals think that way. That's sort of extremist liberal thinking. But because they don't have a problem with government getting in the middle of your stuff, they don't see the problem with government taking a more active role. And I say a more active role because, make no mistake, the government has always had some sort of role in healthcare. That's not a new thing. But what the ACA did is increase that role. And I think that's absolutely the wrong way to solve anything. And you ended up with this huge bill that Congress had to pass. And what did Pelosi say? We have to pass it before we know what's in it. That's an insane way to approach anything. But where I blame the Republicans is, and I brought this up too on the radio edition of Unleashed last week, and you know, Jen argued with me about it, but I think that the Republican Party is also to blame because they have been very uninterested. I'm talking at the national level, by the way. You know, we broadcast from Manchester, New Hampshire, and I understand that in New Hampshire, Republicans were involved in, I think it's called Healthy Kids and maybe some other healthcare program. Okay. But I'm talking in the macro, I'm talking on the national level. Republicans have been very hesitant to address anything about healthcare reform historically, except when they have something to push back against. During the Clinton administration, when Hillary tried to do Hillary Care, I don't think anyone called it Hillary Care at the time. I think that's a term that kind of got attached to it later. But, you know, she tried to tackle healthcare reform, ended up having to give up on it. It was just the headwinds were too strong. You know, eventually she said, there's no way to do this. And at the time, you know, obviously there was a way to do it because the Obama administration found a way. But at the time, she just kind of had to give up. But when that initiative was taking place, of course, you had Republicans going, oh, this is terrible. We can't do this. This is a government takeover of healthcare. This is socialized medicine, which none of this is, by the way. A huge exaggeration on the part of Republicans when they start using that term. Socialized medicine would be a single payer system like they have in Canada. This is none of this is socialized medicine. I hate when everybody, and it's not just Republicans who do it, Democrats do it too, but I hate the way everybody in politics exaggerates and caricatures everything because then it's very difficult to have a discussion about what truly is going on when everybody's exaggerating everything and using hyperbole and kind of talking past each other. I told you, I go off on tangents. It's my frustration with our political dialogue. But historically, Republicans don't have anything to say about healthcare unless they have something to push back against. And that happened with Hillary. And they said, oh, what about our ideas? We have ideas. Why are you ignoring us? And as soon as Hillary gave up, well, they all shut up. All of a sudden, nah, they didn't think anyone wanted to hear their ideas, I guess. They had nothing to say all of a sudden. Same thing with Obamacare. You know, they're trying to put, they're trying to get Obamacare through. And all of a sudden, you know, all these Republicans saying, well, hey, what about us? Aren't you going to listen to us? We have some ideas. We have some alternatives. Oh, really? What are they? And then if you listen close, you hear crickets in the distance. So they didn't have anything. Paul Ryan at one point supposedly was working on something. I don't know what happened to that. Now, this is something that Democrats, I think, have a hard time grasping. And like I said, it's one of the things that drove me out of the party. How, when you make these decisions and you impose increased government regulation on business, you can't then turn around and blame the business for making a business decision. And you certainly, I don't think it's appropriate to publicly shame them for making business decisions. That is a part of capitalism. Look, I'm not an economist, but you know, common sense will tell you, you know, it's the law of cause and effect. If you do something, if government does something that is going to affect these businesses are going to respond in some way. And you can't just assume that the businesses are going to respond in a way that is positive. I saw this firsthand. I used to work at a company. I was a manager of an establishment where we had two full-time employees on site. I was one of them. And I had an assistant manager who was also full-time. That's it. We had a third person in a supervisory position to whom I was able to give 40 hours per week because that's what she wanted. And the only kind of rules were, you know, every once in a while I had to cut her back to 35 hours. Because if she got 40 hours too consistently, she was going to... you know, then we'd be obligated to, under the old laws, give her benefits that the company didn't want to give her. And they were very, even though the ACA has been phased in stages, the company that I worked for at the time was really proactive in adopting, as I know a lot of companies were, in adopting, adapting to the new rules. So all of a sudden, I'm being told I have to take this employee who was part-time, but who was able to work a full-time schedule. I had to cut her to 25 hours a week. And she was not pleased. And this did harm to her economically. Now, the liberal argument, the pro-Obamacare argument to that, I know, is this. And it's not without merit, by the way, but it is this. Well, the company shouldn't be allowed to get away with that without giving her benefits. They shouldn't expect her to work 40 hours a week if they're not going to give her full-time benefits. Now, again, there is merit to that argument. I would say to the person who makes that argument, you're right. They should give her full-time benefits. But here's the problem. Yes, in principle, that's how that should work. If she wants 40 hours and they want her there 40 hours, give her the health care. Give her the health insurance. Absolutely, that should be included. In principle, yes. But sometimes what works in principle doesn't necessarily work in practical terms in the real world. And the real world side of that is this. This particular individual wanted to be there 40 hours. She wasn't there because she was expected to be 40 hours. She wanted that 40 hours because she needed that 40-hour work week to remain in that job and hold out for, hopefully, an eventual promotion when one of us left the company, which is, by the way, what happened. You know, when I left the company, everybody moved up, including her. Now she was able to move into a full-time position getting that health insurance. But, you know, this is not theoretical, hypothetical stuff. When these companies talk about, well, because of the Affordable Care Act, here's the negative effect. Now we got to cut the hours on all these people because we can't afford to give them health insurance. So now we got to take all our full-time employees who are maybe working 30 hours, 35 hours, and tell them, hey, sorry if you want to work all those hours. We can no longer give all those hours to you. That is real world stuff. I saw it happen. And believe me, I've seen on, you know, I've seen plenty of liberals on MSNBC. And don't get me wrong, I happen to be a fan of MSNBC, as longtime viewers know. But I very much prefer them to Fox. But I have seen liberal talking heads on MSNBC going, well, yeah, people bring that up, but that's just theoretical, hypothetical stuff. That's not really happening. It is really happening. I know, because I saw it happen right in front of me. So when you start doing that to these companies and you start putting these additional restrictions on them and legislating this, that has a real world effect. And that has an effect on these employees who are maybe counting on whatever hours they were getting, who are now being cut to 25 hours a week. And then government, in this case, the president is the government representative in this instance, goes out and shames those companies for making a business decision, a capitalistic decision based on the government regulation that has been infringed on them. Now, look, there is some merit to what Obama said. Yes, when you have a CEO earning millions or billions of dollars a year, it would be nice if the company that CEO represents would take care of its employees a little better, increase their wages, give them better benefits, etc. And that doesn't happen in many cases because, greed. And by the way, this is one of my arguments with libertarians about capitalism is they tend to want to remove all regulation and just take the shackles completely off because actually, we're going to be carrying her show, so I can mention her. I had a conversation once with Lauren Rumpler, who hosts a show called True Objective, which we're actually going to be bringing to IPM Nation very shortly. But Lauren and I had a conversation once where, and I've only talked with her in person, I think twice, but we were discussing the libertarian, the objectivist view on economics. And she was saying, look, people are good. And you can count on people to, when you don't tell them what to do, they will ultimately do the right thing. So if you remove all the shackles, remove all government regulation, just get rid of all of it, people will do the right thing. People running these companies will do the right thing. My counter argument to that is, yeah, I think people are basically good, but people are also imperfect. We have flaws. So that makes us vulnerable to things like greed and gluttony and corruption and all this other stuff. So I think it's naive to say if you remove all regulation and you just, you know, this sort of what I think of as kind of this Wild West version of capitalism, that people are going to do the right thing. I don't think it would go that way. There are some things that need to be far less regulated. Certainly. I mean, anyone who's ever had a storefront type of business will tell you, zoning laws are, some of them are just insane and they just zone you to death. You know, if you have a shingle outside on your business to, you know, so people know you're there, it has to be, I mean, they'll regulate that. It has to be, it can only be this many centimeters wide or this many inches tall, and it can only be these colors. And if you put it actually out in front of your building, it can be no further out than X number of meters, whatever. Jen had brought up an example. I don't remember if this was on the air, if this was an off-air conversation. She was talking about a business where, I forget where this was, but somebody had put a sign in front of their business. This was in Concord, New Hampshire. Someone put a sign advertising their business on a couple of posts out in front of their business. And the city had some sort of issue with this and made this guy take the sign off the posts and attach it to the building. So now he's got two signposts there with nothing on them and the sign attached to the building. And it looks really stupid. But apparently the local city council in Concord, New Hampshire decided, well, that's better. That looks better visually, even though it looks stupid. You know, so don't get me wrong. Some regulation absolutely has to go. Probably most of it, because businesses are so over-legislated in this country, just laws on top of laws on top of laws, and they make it so hard. This is the bigger part of what drove me out of the Democratic Party. They make it so hard to do business. They actively discourage entrepreneurship. It drives me nuts. Every politician, regardless of ideology, has at one time or another said in a speech or an interview or in a debate something to the effect of, you know, small business is the engine that drives this economy. Everyone has said that at some point or some variation of it. And yet they make it so hard and so discouraging to open businesses and keep businesses open. And I mean, where we are here in Manchester, New Hampshire, my God, the stories I've heard about how they really discourage you from opening a new business or staying in business. They just make it so tough. And that's something that people like Obama and people with that mindset from that ideology don't understand. I just don't think they're wired. Their brains aren't wired for that. They just don't get it, you know? There is, again, I'm not saying there is no merit in what he said when he points out, again, you have the CEO making all this money, yet they can't afford to give their employees this or that. One of the things I enjoy about being self-employed and why I don't, if I can avoid it, I'd prefer not to go back to ever working for somebody else, at least at some sort of full-time position, is because while it's difficult for guys like Obama to understand that whole cause and effect thing between government and capitalism, it's also very difficult for a lot of employers to understand that. And again, to me, this is just common sense. If you treat your people right, if you pay them a decent wage, if you give them reasonably good benefits, and if you treat them with some level of respect and dignity and not just like a number, they will be happier at the job and they will be more productive and have a better attitude. And the whole thing will have a better vibe to it, you know. Very basic concept, very common sense. How many employers actually understand that? It's like this weird thing where I think the larger the company, the less they care. I mean, I can tell you also, there's an employer that I worked for where it was very clear the attitude was, we don't have to be nice to you. If you don't like it, go find another job. What do we care? We'll just replace you. And again, it's very foolish fiscally for a business to run that way because it costs money to hire and train a new person every time somebody walks. But they would rather do that. They would actually, so many companies are like that. They would actually rather do that than worry about just treating you with some dignity and respect and paying you a decent wage. There is a dark side to all this. And so not everything that Obama's saying here is wrong. But again, it's that whole cause and effect thing. Of course, this was going to happen. This was all completely predictable. That Staples would do this, that other companies are doing it. One of the things, and I told him this when I met him, if you're joining us late, next week, Jen Coffey and I will be talking with U.S. Congressman Frank Ginta. He'll be here with us. One of the things I complimented on when I got to speak with him in person briefly was, instead of repeating that whole ridiculous repeal and replace mantra that so many Republicans have clung to. We first saw that pop up during the 2012 campaigns, and some of them are still repeating that. you know, Congressman Ginta has been saying, well, what we need to focus on is reform. Reform the parts of the ACA that don't work, that need to be changed. And that, to me, is how it should be approached. You know, the whole repeal and replace thing is just stupid. Granted, a lot of Republicans, to their credit, like the congressman, have moved away from that, which I think is very smart. They should have moved away from it long ago. But there's still some. I mean, they voted, what was it, last week or the week before? I think for the 58th time in Congress, the Republicans, the House tried to vote on repealing Obamacare, knowing it had no chance of passing. Just another in this series of grand symbolic gestures, because that's why we send these people to Washington, right, and pay their salaries for these grand symbolic gestures that end up not adding up to anything. Stupid. So I'm glad some Republicans are beginning to move away from that and approaching it pragmatically and practically and saying, well, we can't repeal this and we have nothing to replace it with. So let's work on reforming the parts of it that need reform and acknowledging, too, that there are some good things about it. I have not met anyone who can argue against the pre-existing condition part. You know, that needed to be dealt with. And, you know, being able to keep your kids, I think, until they're 26 on your health care if they're in college. You know, there are some things to this that even Republicans can agree with. So that's what needs to happen going forward. The other thing, again, it's a good thing I put up that disclaimer at the beginning of the show, because I'm slamming Obama quite a bit this week because I have something else. Take this how you want it, but I thought this was interesting. This is from Huffington Post. This went up yesterday morning. Sam Stein and Amanda Turkle wrote this. 16 times the Obama administration lied about the president's position on same-sex marriage. You remember that moment a couple of years ago? He had evolved on this issue after Biden kind of stepped out of line on Meet the Press and said, you know, he's pro-gay marriage. Not unprecedented, by the way. Something similar happened during the Bush administration. There's the George W. Bush administration. There's an interesting parallel here. That people forget about. But Vice President Dick Cheney, you know, he has a gay daughter. And even the most conservative folks tend to, if they actually know someone who's gay or have someone who's gay in their family, they tend to look at this a little differently. And for those of you who weren't aware, Dick Cheney is pro-gay marriage. And that did come up during an interview when he was a sitting vice president. But it wasn't a big deal like it was when Biden did it. Cheney didn't make a big deal about it. He just said, look, President Bush and I don't agree on everything. There are some areas of disagreement. He said, as a vice president, it is my job as a member of this administration to uphold the positions of the administration. The president sets the policy. So I have to, in my role as VP, I have to, I don't remember how he phrased it exactly, but has to kind of fall in line behind that. President sets policy. It wasn't a big deal, but he's never shied away from, when asked about it or when it's come up, that he is pro-gay marriage. So he was actually at one time to the left of Obama, because Obama, as we know, has not always been pro-gay marriage. By the way, one of the interesting, you know, the law of unintended consequences, we see this so much in politics, and it's fascinating to me. In 2008, when they had that debacle with Prop 8 in California, where they had put in by referendum gay marriage and then overturned it via referendum, via Prop 8. And at that time, political analysts said that it was because of Obama, because you had the African-American vote turn out at unprecedented levels to vote for President Barack Obama. And at that time, and I think this has changed, but in 2008, typically a lot of African Americans tended to be a bit conservative on some social issues like gay marriage. So these African American voters voting for Obama would at the same time vote against gay marriage. So they voted to repeal gay marriage in California. So Obama has some unintended, you know, sort of tangential history in this, in that regard. It's kind of ironic, but. Let me read this article to you. It's brief. I know we already have only about 10 minutes left, but it can now apparently be told. During his run for the presidency in his first years in the White House, President Barack Obama deceived the American public about his position on same-sex marriage. The revelation, underwhelming as it may be, to those who followed the debate closely, came in a passage from the president's longtime aide and advisor, David Axelrod, in his new book, Believer, My 40 Years in Politics. Axelrod admits that Obama personally supported the legalization of marriage equality for same-sex couples, but claimed he didn't for political reasons. Gay marriage was a particularly nagging issue. For as long as we had been working together, Obama felt... Okay, and this is from Axelrod's book, this part, just to be clear. Gay marriage was a particularly nagging issue. For as long as we had been working together, Obama had felt a tug between his personal views and his politics of gay marriage. He grudgingly accepted the counsel of more pragmatic folks like me and modified his position to support civil unions rather than marriage, which he would term a, quote, sacred union. Having prided himself on forthrightness, though, Obama never felt comfortable with his compromise and, no doubt, compromised position. He routinely stumbled over the question when it came up in debates or interviews. He said, quote, I'm just not very good at BSing, unquote, he said with a sigh after one such awkward exchange. It had long been assumed that Obama supported... Okay, that's from Axelrod's book. And back to the article. It had long been assumed that Obama supported gay marriage and hid it for the sake of political expedience. After all, he had signed a questionnaire in 1996 while running for the state senate in Illinois, saying he was a proponent. Would it really be possible that he regressed while the rest of the country evolved? Of course not, and yet there is something striking about Axelrod's passage, if only because it puts an end to the lengthy series of misdirection, spin, and even lies that the administration told for years to avoid revealing Obama's true belief on the matter. Dating back to a Senate run in 2004, Obama has and his aides repeatedly insisted that he wasn't yet fully comfortable with marriage for gay couples as a right, even though he clearly was. As the New York Times' Mike Barbero put it, Obama finally publicly stated he supported same-sex marriage in May 2012. Here are 16 instances in which Obama or his team basically lied about his position. Obama said, undecided, in an answer to a questionnaire that asked, do you favor legalizing same-sex marriage in 1998? Obama said, quote, I am a fierce supporter of domestic partnership and civil union laws. I'm not a supporter of gay marriage as it has been thrown about, primarily just as a strategic issue. I think that marriage, in the minds of a lot of voters, has a religious connotation, unquote. That is according to the Windy City Times, February 4th, 2004. Obama, I'm a Christian. And so, although I try not to have my religious beliefs dominate or determine my political views on this issue, I do believe that tradition and my religious beliefs say that marriage is something sanctified between a man and a woman, unquote. It goes on from there. I'm not going to read through all of these. There are a total of 16 examples. You can find the article. If you want to go through all 16, like I said, it's on HuffPost. It's called 16 Times the Obama Administration Lied About the President's Position on Same-Sex Marriage. Some of these quotes aren't from Obama specifically, but from others in his administration, including Robert Gibbs, Jay Carney, et cetera, and David Axelrod himself. So I'm not going to read the whole thing to you, but you know, it's interesting. And of course, longtime viewers of the show know I fully support marriage equality. I think, what are we up to now? 37 states? I think Alabama was the most recent one. You know, it's interesting to see these so-called red states, like Alabama, for example, that are now going for full marriage equality. And, you know, I think the Republican Party is going to have to, as a whole, embrace it. I mean, a lot of Republicans do already. You know, Jen certainly does, and she's a Republican. But, you know, I think some of this is generational. I think older Christian conservative Republicans are still freaked out by it. They think that, you know, it just completely undermines marriage. They think it weakens it, essentially. They see it as a change in the definition of marriage, and that weakens marriage as an institution. My argument is, no, it doesn't weaken it. I think it strengthens it. I think by inviting more people to participate in marriage, people who want to participate in marriage, who want to have the right to do that, I think it actually strengthens marriage, not weakens it. That's my position. We only have a little bit of time left, so we'll hit something quick here. Last night on the radio edition of Unleashed, we had Matt Simon on. He's the New England political director for the Marijuana Policy Project. If you miss the show, by the way, if you go to dkrn.fm, look at the schedule, you can see the replay times, and we'll get it up on IPM Nation as well. Also, a couple of weeks ago, Matt Simon was my guest here for the television edition of Matt Connerton Unleashed. And, you know, he's currently working on, for example, here in New Hampshire, you know, getting medical marijuana finally, you know, on the books and active in a way that people can actually participate in it. And, you know, I see it as a moral issue. If people are suffering, if there's something that can medically help them, let them have it. End of story, period. It really is as simple as that. Human beings are suffering. But one of the things that, has come up in this debate is, you know, we've talked a lot with Matt. I talked about it with him here, and it came up last night. Jen and I talked to him on the radio edition about some of the misinformation about marijuana and how it's been demonized and caricatured and, you know, made to sound like it's this terrible, dangerous thing, when obviously, I mean, common sense will tell you it's far less dangerous than alcohol, far less dangerous than cigarettes. But I thought this was interesting as it relates to some of the misconceptions. Matt Ferner wrote this. This was on HuffPost this morning. Stoned drivers at far lower risk of crash than drunken drivers. So this is a short article. I'll just read this to you. A government study on impaired driving released last week found that drivers who had used marijuana were at a far lower risk of getting into an accident than drivers who had used alcohol. The Drug and Alcohol Crash Risk Report, produced by the Department of Transportation's National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, found that while drunken driving drastically increased the risk of getting into an accident, there was no evidence that using marijuana heightened that risk. In fact, after adjusting for age, gender, race, and alcohol use, the report found that stoned drivers were no more likely to crash than drivers who were not intoxicated at all. However, the federal researchers say that their report's findings, quote, do not indicate that drug use by drivers is risk-free, adding that the study limitations, together with the findings of numerous other studies using different and complementary methods, need to be carefully considered before more definitive conclusions about drug use and crash risk can be reached, unquote. The data showed just how dangerous it is to drive while drunk. You know what? I'm not going to read this entire article to you. It's actually a little longer than I thought, but you can find it on HuffPost. Again, Matt Ferner is the author. Stone drivers at far lower risk of crash than drunken drivers. The point is this. There is nothing prohibiting you from going out and purchasing alcohol. It is perfectly legal. And the government is going to trust you to make a responsible decision with that alcohol, to not imbibe too much, and then go out and operate heavy machinery like a car. The government trusts you to make that determination. They don't trust you too much. You know, they're still going to be, the cops are still going to be out there keeping an eye out for you. If they see you swerving and they suspect you're drunk, they're going to pull you over, as they should. And there should be very stiff penalties for that. I have no sympathy at all for people who drive drunk and get caught and it wrecks their lives. I don't. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, if you're going to drive drunk, you know, it's no different than walking up to a crowd of people with a loaded gun and just aimlessly pointing it and seeing if you hit anybody. You know, I have no sympathy for drunk drivers. But the government, because alcohol is legal, and for example, in the state of New Hampshire, our state government is actually involved in the alcohol business, right? We have state-run liquor stores right on the highway. Right on the highway. Come on, pull on in, get your alcohol. We're going to trust you not to open it on your way home and get drunk while you're still on the roads. But when it comes to marijuana, where there is apparently very little risk of it impairing you to the point where you can't drive, no. Marijuana has to be illegal. It's very dangerous, and the government knows what's best, and it has to be illegal, even though no one's ever died from marijuana use. You know, it can be helpful in certain medical conditions. It can probably be, you know, when Matt Simon was here, I said this only half joking, but there was a serious point underneath it. If everybody would toke up once in a while, the world would probably be a much less violent place. You know, everybody would be a little more laid back, a little bit less aggressive, and I think it would actually be a good thing. And again, I say that only half kidding. But, you know, that really struck me when I saw that this morning, and I thought, I've got to bring that up today on the show. A bunch of stuff I didn't get to. I wanted to talk about Brian Williams a little bit. Didn't get to that. And there's some other Obama stuff, but never fear, because there's always a chance that we'll get to it on the next show. So, of course, Matt Connerton Unleashed. We're live every Wednesday on IPMNation.com. You can stream it live, and then the show will be available by around 10 p.m. tonight on IPMNation.com. Don't forget the radio edition of Unleashed every Tuesday and Thursday night with my co-host Jen Coffee on IPM. You can get it on IPMNation.com, also on DKRN.fm as well. And don't forget, tonight at 7 p.m. on IPMNation.com, on our new 24/7 live station, will be premiering Local Outbreak. The show isn't new. I've been doing that for about 6 years, but we'll be broadcasting it live for the first time on IPM Nation at the same time that it will be available on 100.1 The Planet, our FM affiliate that carries the show also. So it's a big day, lots of stuff going on, big week, big month, big year. 2015 is going to be a big year around here. Very excited. So don't forget, Congressman Frank Ginta will be with Jen and I here next week. And if you are watching live on Wednesday, I will be back at 6 p.m. with the Honorable Gary S. Hopper. I have no idea who our guest is, but sometimes it's fun to be surprised. Anyway, that's it for now. I'll talk at you all a little bit later. Thanks.